I'm Dr. Sean Gray. I'm your presenter this morning. I'd like to welcome you all to today's webcast on navigating brain injury care in Alberta and beyond. But before we get to the webcast presentation, though, I wanted to mention that these webcasts are part of a larger joint initiative by the Government of Alberta called the Human Services Learning Initiative. For more information about this series, check your emails for regular updates or go to hslearningseries.ca. Now, one of the things you'll be able to do is to pose your questions to me directly via a live chat window. So if you have yet to access the chat, I'd suggest you try it out now. Scroll down in your viewing window to find it, and I'll try and address as many of these questions at the end of the presentation as possible. So Paige Boudreau is our online moderator, and she'll pose your web chat questions to me at the question and answer period at the end of the presentation. So today's session is also being recorded, and the video will be posted on the hslearningseries.ca website about 2 weeks after the live session or so. So let's get it going. So I'm a physiatrist at the Glen Rose Rehabilitation Hospital here in Edmonton. And I've worked in the area of brain injury and neural rehabilitation for about the last, 25, 26 years, something like that. So what I thought we would do as part of this presentation is to talk about a few things. So I'd like to review brain injury in general as a major public health issue. I'd like to discuss brain injury care and kind of the continuum of care with particular reference to Alberta. And then I'd like to talk a little bit about new research and kind of let you know what some of the new things that are coming down the pipe might be kind of at each stage of the continuum of care and how this research has translated into patient care activities. And then finally, discuss some of the implications of this new research for future survivor care. Well, so every good talk on brain injury always starts with a definition and a whole bunch of statistics, so I'm no different, so we're going to do exactly the same thing. So according to the CDC, the Center for Disease Control in the States, a traumatic brain injury involves any period of loss or decreased consciousness, a loss of memory for events immediately before or after the injury, so what's called anterograde amnesia or retrograde amnesia. You can have neurologic deficits such as muscle weakness, loss of balance, loss of coordination, disruption of vision, change in speech and language or sensory loss, and any alteration in mental state at the time of injury such as confusion, disorientation, slowed thinking or difficulty with concentration. So I think you can appreciate from that definition that there's a broad spectrum of types and severities of brain injury that would still fall into the general rubric of traumatic brain injury. And there's also lots of other ways to acquire a brain injury as well. That could include things like stroke, infections, loss of oxygen to the brain, toxins. People have been hearing an awful lot about the kind of the fentanyl crisis these days and opioid challenges in our society right now. A brain injury usually occurs on a background of stable neurologic function. So it's somebody who's kind of chugging along through their normal day-to-day life at their normal stable level of neurologic function. Some event happens that results in an injury to their brain. And it results in a temporary or enduring impairment of cognitive, physical, and behavioral functions. Now, the thing that distinguishes, I think, brain injury from many other types of neurologic dysfunction is that it's characterized by the capacity for a progressive recovery of function post-injury. So this little graphic is just my kind of cheesy little way of trying to illustrate this. So here you're chugging along at some functional level. Some event happens as marked by the large blue arrow there. Your level of function suddenly decreases as a result of the injury, and then following that, assuming that you survive the initial insult, there will be some progressive recovery of function after the event. So that's different than other types of neurologic diseases, such as degenerative neurologic diseases, which are illustrated by the red line there, where you see a progressive loss of function. So that's the one big difference between acquired brain injuries, and degenerative type neurologic injury. So how common is it? Well, I think it's, you know, it often surprises people to discover how frequent and how common traumatic brain injury is in society. We don't track it particularly well, unfortunately, so estimates vary depending on which jurisdiction you look at and depending on who you read and when you read it. But somewhere around 100 to 200, maybe even up to 300 people per 100,000 per year sustain a traumatic brain injury. So if you think about, let's take 200 per 100,000, and you say, well, Edmonton's a million here, well, that's 2,000 people a year have some kind of traumatic brain injury, just traumatic brain injury alone. The interesting thing about this, and of particular relevance to Canada and Alberta in particular, is that the incidence is higher in rural areas than it is in urban areas. So when you think about it, that kind of makes sense. I mean, what do you do in urban areas? Well, I mean, that's where a lot of the high-risk occupations are, forestry, mining, agriculture, the oil patch, you know, very, very common source of traumatic injury. People's recreational activity in rural areas tends to also involve things that maybe put them a little bit more risk, ATVs and sleds and that sort of thing. So it's almost to the point where the incidence of traumatic brain injury in rural areas is almost double that in urban areas. Now, so why is that important? Well, it's important because where are most of the services concentrated in the health and human services sector? They tend to be concentrated in urban areas, not in rural areas. When people have a traumatic brain injury, they really want to go home afterwards, right? So I think it has some relevance to how we allocate and disperse services around the province and accessibility to those services as well. So if you compare it to stroke, it's about roughly the same incidence as stroke. So according to the Heart and Stroke Foundation, the incidence of stroke in our society is about 165 per 100,000 population. Traumatic brain injury costs us a lot of money. So it's been estimated by the Ontario Brain Injury Association that the cost of traumatic brain injury alone in Canada is about $3 to $10 billion a year. And in the EU, about $33 billion, and in the US, about $56-57 billion. Some of that from direct medical costs, so about 12-15% direct medical costs. But most of it in injury-related work loss and disability and lost revenue from premature death. So it's a big societal issue. If you look at Canada specifically, this is a report that the Public Health Commission put out in 2014 called Making Connections. And really what they did is they looked at neurologic disability in Canada from a variety of sources and kind of looked at things like healthcare costs and incidents and that sort of thing. So I, you know, it's a very tiny little graphic there. So if you look at the actual cost, this is data from BC, from British Columbia, and you look at the cost per traumatic brain injury, it's about $86,000 in direct healthcare costs. So that's a fairly significant cost to our healthcare system for something that, for the most part, is generally preventable. If you look at the economic costs overall in Alberta, or sorry, in Canada, this is traumatic brain injury compared to other neurologic disabilities. And I think you can appreciate, you know, just kind of look at the graph in general and then the magnified little portion of it here. I think you can appreciate that traumatic brain injury is an extremely costly public health issue in Canada. So by far and away, the economic cost to our society from traumatic brain injury exceeds that of any other neurologic disability that was looked at in this report. So what about what's happening over time? So you would think that with lots of public awareness now, and you know, people wear helmets and there's a lot more kind of initiatives around prevention, you would hope that the incidence is decreasing. Well, in fact, in the period from 1994 to 2004, according to the Canadian Institute for Health Information, there was about a 35% overall decrease in traumatic brain injury, but there was a 46% increase in severe traumatic brain injury. In Alberta, we don't really have any good data. So we don't actually have a good registry for traumatic brain injury in Alberta. Interestingly, in the U.S., the rate of hospitalization hasn't actually changed. So even though we may be reducing some form of traumatic brain injury in some fashion, the rate of hospitalization and the actual costs are staying relatively stable. So if we look, I gotta get my bifocals in the right spot here so I can see what we're talking about here. So if we're looking at the projected numbers, in fact, the projected incidence of traumatic brain injury, according to the Public Health Commission, is not going to change. In fact, it's going to go up. So they're saying that it's about 60 per 100,000 right now in terms of hospitalizations. And in the next two decades, that is not projected to change significantly. In fact, it's projected to go up to 70 per 100,000. So this is going to, I guess the only point in there, or the major point in there, is that this is a significant public health issue that is not seemingly going away. We're not making significant inroads in kind of reducing the overall incidence or the costs in general. Well, look, okay, so that's great. That's sort of the incidence of traumatic brain injury. What's important is what's the disability, or what happens to people after their traumatic brain injuries. Remember I said that it's characterized by a progressive return of function. Well, often that function does not return to baseline, so people end up with disabilities after their injuries. And if you look at the U.S. data, the United States Brain Injury Association estimates that about 2% roughly of the U.S. population has a long-term disability that's related to traumatic brain injury alone. That's a lot of people. That's about 5.3 million people who have a long-term disability related to a traumatic brain injury. About 80,000 people per year have the onset of long-term disability. And what that suggests then is that there's a cumulative need for services and long-term follow-up. And the same sort of rural-urban split holds for disability as well as it does for incidents at the time of the initial trauma. So there is a significantly higher percentage of people with disability in rural areas than there is in urban areas. Again, something that's relevant to us designing services for people with disability in the community. Worldwide, neurotrauma is the third leading cause of mortality and disability by 2020 in the world. So we're seeing an actual increase over time, particularly with increasing mechanization and vehicularization, if you like, if that's a real word, as people are becoming more mobile around the world and there's better access to motor vehicles and transportation and so on and so forth. If you compare that to other disabilities, other neurodisabilities, what's the relative incidence of disability related to traumatic brain injury to, say, things like stroke? Well, in fact, if you look at stroke, overall, it's about half the rate of disability relative to traumatic brain injury. So in the population at large, it's about 1%. Now, if you look at those over the age of 65, it's actually about 4%. So there's a significantly higher percentage of people. And when you think about it, that makes sense. I mean, who gets strokes? For the most part, it's not your 25-year-old guy driving his, F-150 on the highway. It's an older population who tend to be more susceptible to stroke. So it makes more sense from that perspective, right? Well, this is a slide. This is again from the Center for Disease Control. In this little pie chart, what it's intended to represent is what's the disability, or what's the incidence of disability, the prevalence of disability, with respect to other types of illnesses or neurodisabilities. So if you compare that, so the red portion there is disability related to traumatic brain injury, compared to things like multiple sclerosis, spinal cord injury, and so forth. So if you look at traumatic spinal cord, for example, it's about 0.1% relative to 2% for traumatic brain injury. So even though we hear a lot about other types of neurodisability, like multiple sclerosis and spinal cord injury and other types of etiologies, far and away, the amount of disability that's caused by traumatic brain injury exceeds that of the other types of neurodisability. So, and I think that's an underappreciated point. And I think, it certainly, speaks to things like, so What's the public awareness? How do we generate awareness? How do we generate funding? How do we approach the problems of prevention and by driving awareness from a public perspective? So what I wanted to talk about a little bit was, where are we in Alberta? At least as best as I could guess, based on the numbers that we have in terms of 2%, 2% disability and so on and so forth. So in 1995, which is not that long ago, at least from my perspective, it's not that long ago, we had a population in Alberta of about 2.5 million people. So if you kind of look at those disability rates, what it would suggest is that we would have about 1,500 traumatic brain injuries a year, we might have about 3,000 strokes a year, roughly, and we had about 75,000 people in the province with disability. We had 6,500 hospital beds for the entire province at that point. And that was after the, how can I put this politically correctly? After the adjustment in hospital beds in the early 90s. How things changed? So we're now, in 2016, we've added about 2 million people to the population of Alberta. So we're now about 4.5 million people. So if you do the numbers, that's about 2,700 traumatic brain injuries a year, 6,700 strokes a year, and about 135,000 people in our province, just an estimate, with disability related to traumatic brain injury. That's a lot of people. In terms of the hospital beds and the ability to provide service from that perspective, that has not gone up proportionately. So we're at about 8,400 hospital beds right now, according to the Alberta Health Services website. So that leads to things like news stories like this: Alberta's short more than 3,300 hospital beds. So again, it speaks to the issues of service and access, and how do we provide care to people with traumatic brain injury. So I'm going to shift gears a little bit, and we're going to talk a little bit about navigating the system and kind of what is the system for brain injury care. So it's actually a pretty complex system. So this little diagram of the traffic interchange really, I think, represents how many survivors and families feel, and providers and caregivers, as far as that goes, feel about the system in general, in terms of how do you negotiate and navigate care after the initial traumatic incident. And I think it's important to remember that brain injury care extends right from the time of injury throughout life. So once somebody has survived and they're now surviving with an enduring disability, that need for access to services can be perpetual and kind of go on throughout life. So in Alberta, we have lots of service providers. Some are publicly funded, some are not. Many services have restrictive criteria for participation, so you need to fall into a certain group in order to access those services. Either some level of disability or some type of disability or some age group or some other criteria. So the other thing is not only is it restricted in terms of how you can access or what services you can access, but the availability of those services also varies significantly across the province. And that sort of gets back to speaking to that rural-urban split that we were talking about earlier. So again, I'm kind of a simple-minded guy, so I like to think about things in terms of, you know, straightforward, you know, kind of how can I visualize this whole spectrum of care from the time of injury. So this little diagram is, again, just a graphic representation of kind of how I think things should go and could go in the long run after somebody has sustained an injury. So if we say, well, if we can't prevent an injury, and somebody has an injury, what happens afterwards? Well, remember I said that traumatic brain injury, or acquired brain injury in particular, is characterized by some degree of improvement, even if we did nothing. So that's kind of represented by the little red line there. So with no particular treatment, that's what's kind of the outcome is going to be. What we hope, though, is that we can improve those outcomes somehow and make things better for people in the long run. So we think that maybe we can make it better. Maybe we can do something that will improve outcome, facilitate recovery of function, improve quality of life. So that's represented by the kind of the little yellow arrow there, or the yellow line. What we don't want to do is make things worse. So we don't want to create the little purple line at the bottom there where we've done something or some intervention that's made the outcome or the functional recovery for individuals worse. So when you think about that now, and you think about the spectrum of services that we provide, it kind of goes across the continuum over the lifespan. So if that bottom line or the bottom axis represents time since injury, so you have your acute care, so that's when the, you know, STARS arrives or the ambulance arrives and pries you out of the vehicle and, you know, whisks you off to a trauma center. So that's kind of that acute care phase, and we do a bunch of stuff there, and you may have some surgical intervention or something else may happen in acute care. And then hopefully you get on to a formalized rehabilitation program. But those are relatively small parts of what happens for people post-injury. So most of what happens for people post-injury is this lifelong living phase. So what we're trying to do then, I think, is alter the trajectory from no treatment to best possible outcome. So hopefully that's what I'm going to call the kind of the treatment or the rehabilitation effect. Okay? So with the proper intervention and proper technology and the proper application of the appropriate care, we can improve people's long-term disability and improve their quality of life and function. Okay, well, that sounds really easy. And that diagram sort of suggests that, well, there's this nice linear flow, and you kind of go to acute care, you go to rehabilitation, and then you go home, and you're as best as you can possibly be once you return to the community. Well, that may not be completely true, in the sense that the system isn't quite that straightforward or quite that linear. So this little roadmap, and I'm missing stuff off of this. I agonized over how many things I needed to put in there, or how many I could get in there and still make the diagram even legible. So you can see that it's pretty confusing. So on the top left-hand corner there, you have your injury, and then you'll either be sent home, or you might not even go to hospital. So if you have a mild traumatic brain injury, kind of a concussion type injury, you might not even seek medical care, so you might just go home. That doesn't mean you won't have some ongoing problems after that, but it just means that you didn't sort of seek formal medical care for your injury. Or you'll go to emergency services. So you go to the emergency room, or the ambulance comes, or STARS arrives, or something else happens. Then you'll end up in hospital. Then the system starts to get a little bit more convoluted, depending on where you are in terms of the type of injury that you had, the severity of injury you had, and the type of disability that you may have had post-injury. So I think you can appreciate that, you know, you can go from emergency services, you might go to your home hospital, so even if you got flown here, for example, you may do well enough that somebody feels, well, we either need to await rehabilitation because there's no rehab bed available, in the trauma center that you're at, so you may go home to your home hospital to await readmission and whatever services are available to you in your home hospital. You may end up in tertiary acute care, have some kind of trauma intervention, be then sent to inpatient rehabilitation and sort of the more formalized rehabilitation programs in the province. You might go to longer term inpatient rehabilitation, say, you know, in places like the Halvor Johnson Center in Pinoca, for example. You might end up being sent to a long-term care facility because your needs are such that they cannot be provided for in the community or at home. After that, it becomes a mishmash of all kinds of other access to services. So you may access outpatient rehabilitation. You may need some special education activity, depending on your age. You may have community supported living in things like group homes or designated assisted living facilities. You may access community-based services such as support networks, support groups, or access some community integration supports through things like the Human Services Initiative and the Alberta Brain Injury Network. Now, what I haven't put in this is some of the other issues that happen following brain injury. So that's mental health and addiction services. So there's no specific real, this is a pressing need in traumatic brain injury rehabilitation, not only in terms of the direct consequences of the brain injury that we'll talk about in a little bit, but also in terms of adjustment to the changed life circumstances that people have, or things like post-traumatic stress disorder, or all kinds of other psychological issues and mental health issues that can result from the initial trauma, not only for the survivor, but also for their families. So, in theory, what should happen then is this sort of mental health and addictions access to services should flow over the entire continuum and be accessible throughout the person's journey throughout the rest of their life. That is not always the case. So what is it that then determines your access to services? Well, it depends on lots of variables. So it depends on the type and severity of injury that you had. So somebody who's had a mild traumatic brain injury, for example, may not be able to access inpatient rehabilitation at all. Somebody who's had an extremely severe traumatic brain injury may not be able to participate in a rehabilitation program to meet the criteria that we often have for participation in inpatient rehabilitation programs of, you know, being able to participate in activity for 3 hours out of the day and to sit upright, for example, you know. So somebody who's had an extremely severe injury and is severely disabled as a result of that may not be able to access those services, and they may not be able to access rehabilitation services in general. It may depend on what the estimate is or what the guess of your outcome is going to be. And I'm going to talk about that again in a little bit more, in a little bit more detail. But so if we, you know, if there's a sense that somebody is going to do well post-injury, that may determine where they can access services. Or if somebody feels that that person may not have a significant chance of meaningful recovery from their brain injury, then that may also determine where they go. It may depend on what kind of disability you have after your brain injury. So if you have a primarily cognitive disability and not a physical disability, you may not be able to access certain services, but you may be eligible for certain other services that somebody with a behavior problem may not be able to access. So it does depend a bit on the type of disability. It depends on where you are in your recovery. So one of the features in our system, in that little roadmap I showed you, is that most of those arrows are one way. And that's, practically speaking, that's essentially what happens. So if you're in one place and you move along to the next step in that little roadmap, it's very difficult to go backwards. So once you've been discharged from a rehabilitation facility, for example, it's very hard to come back 2 or 3 years later and re-access those rehabilitation services, partly because of the demand and partly because of limited, you know, kind of limited resources in general. So there is a resource allocation issue here as well. It also depends on your geographic location, and it depends how old you are. If you're 80 and sustain a traumatic brain injury, you may be eligible or may be considered for different services than somebody who's 20, for example. It may depend on where you live in the province. So not everybody has equal access to rehabilitation services or to the sophistication of rehabilitation services across the province. And some of that is not necessarily a resource issue, which of course it is to a certain extent, but it's also an issue of transportation, and it's an issue of access. So it's very difficult for somebody who, say, doesn't drive in our province to access public transportation, even if you're just in kind of the donut area around Calgary or Edmonton, to access those services to try and get in to access rehabilitation services for you and your family is often very challenging. We were talking earlier about in the room here about hospital parking costs. So you know, and if you even just think about that, you know, if you're a family member and you got to pay $15 a day to park, that can be a challenge for some individuals and their families. Depends on what services are in the community. So community services are not evenly distributed around the province. Some places are really good, some places have minimal services available. And it may also depend on the advocacy that you or your family can generate for yourself. You know, and there is an element of squeaky wheels getting greased. So if you have a strong advocate and you can present a strong case for why you should access certain services, or you have an insurer, or you have somebody else who can act on your behalf, you may have access to different services. Right? One of the issues with brain injury is that people, the survivors themselves, often have difficulty organizing and kind of creating a plan to move forward. So sometimes very challenging if you're the individual to then try and map out where you're supposed to go, given the complexity of the system that we've been talking about. So let's just talk a little bit about some of those variables. So what about type and severity of injury? Well, in traumatic brain injury, we talked about the incidence and we talked about the number of people with disability. The vast majority of people actually have relatively mild traumatic brain injuries, so about 80%. So those are people who have a disruption of consciousness or an amnestic period that is relatively short, and they usually don't have significant depression of consciousness that persists for any prolonged period of time. They often don't seek medical attention, so this is the kind of the sports-related concussion kind of folks, or some of the blast injury type things that the military has seen, where you may not have a persisting disruption of consciousness, but you may end up with a persisting disability or persisting issues post insult. About 10% of brain injuries are so-called moderate brain injuries. So this is a Glasgow Coma Scale, a score between 9 and 13. And severe traumatic brain injuries are anybody with a Glasgow Coma Scale of less than 8. So again, representing about 10%. So in stroke, we tend to differentiate between stroke and traumatic brain injury. So people who are post-stroke tend to access very stroke-specific types of programming. And usually, it's people who get into rehabilitation programs are kind of what we refer to colloquially as the middle band. So these are people who are in a kind of a middle level of functional disability. So if you're very severely disabled and unable to participate in a rehab program, you probably won't get into a rehab program. If you're too good, in quotation marks, you probably won't get into a rehabilitation program because you can be discharged to the community and survive and manage your own activities of daily living in the community, or you have significant support, or you have significant community supports to help you. What about outcome prediction? So remember I mentioned that one of the things that determines where you go is based on an estimate of what your future recovery may be. Well, it turns out that we're really lousy at that in general. So there's some new research is coming out using functional MRI to look at kind of what's the interior state, if you like, of people who appear to be behaviorally unresponsive in what's been called a persisting post-coma unawareness state, or what used to be called a vegetative state, or the minimally conscious state. And it turns out that many times we're wrong. So according to data from Stephen Laurie's lab, about 40% of the time we're wrong. You know, when we say somebody's in a post-coma unawareness state or persisting vegetative state, we're actually wrong. And many of those people will recover some level of consciousness. The issue and the importance of that, though, is that it may actually determine where you go. So if I, as the treating physician, sort of say, well, this person's in a persisting vegetative state, then they really aren't going to be able to participate in rehabilitation. Now what do we do? Well, you know, then the discharge location may be long-term care with minimal relative follow-up after that from a systemic perspective. Now the interesting thing about that is that if you actually have more consciousness retained, if you like, if I can use that phrase, without the capacity to behaviorally demonstrate it other than through very sophisticated technologies, you might actually be able to answer questions and direct your own care, even though you may not be able to lift a finger or blink an eye to communicate with people. But using things like fMRI or EEG technologies, and there's a fair bit of research that's going on in this area right now. Now, it may also have an impact. What we think is going to be your predicted outcome may actually have a significant impact on treatment aggressiveness early on in acute care as well. So, you know, there was an interesting study that came out in the Canadian Medical Association Journal in 2011. There was a six-site Canadian study where they looked at level one trauma sites across Canada and looked at what was the probability of you surviving your traumatic brain injury and leaving the ICU. And in fact, it varied significantly. It varied from 10% to 44% across sites. Now, why was that? Well, presumably they're all level one trauma sites. They're all using the latest in trauma technology and trauma care. So why was the difference? Well, the deaths, the people who died, seemed to be mostly due to the withdrawal of therapy in the first 3 days of care. So, and it was based on the estimation of poor prognosis, despite really any good prognostic tests that we have to determine what somebody's long-term recovery may be. So it is an important issue because it may actually determine kind of the aggressiveness that you get treated with. This is not just a Canadian phenomenon by any means, and certainly these data have been replicated in the U.S. and in Europe as well, that there's a lot of intra-site variability to the tune of almost three times variability in terms of what your probability of leaving a particular intensive care unit may be after sustaining a severe traumatic brain injury. Well, what happens after a brain injury? Well, I like to kind of categorize things a little bit, and I think about the disability post-brain injury in these three major domains. So the physical domain, cognitive domains, behavioral domains, and they happen generally not in isolation. So, but you can certainly have a consequence from your brain injury that is more in the cognitive domain, for example, or more in the physical domain, or more potentially in the behavioral or psychiatric domain. And it also depends on what kind of person or what kind of brain you had before you had your brain injury. So this was recognized way back in 1934 by Sir Charles Simmons, who said it's not only the kind of injury that matters, but the kind of brain. So what you may see is an exaggeration of somebody's pre-injury personality, or you may see a completely different person, or you may see, you know, a completely different capacity for community integration and the ability to kind of do your own activities of daily living or your instrumental activities, and you may require assistance in certain domains and not in others, and so on and so forth. Okay. Well, in the physical domain, this is what we're all used to. I mean, this is kind of what, you know, rehabilitation professionals are typically engaged with. Okay, so these are the issues of medical kinds of issues. They're things like, you know, paralysis or spasticity or some of the millions of other consequences that can happen as a result of injury to the brain. And I guess one way to think about it is that, you know, your brain is kind of you, and your brain kind of controls everything, right from, you know, kind of basic so-called vegetative functions like how fast your heart is beating, how hard it's beating, how fast you're breathing, what your oxygenation is like, so on and so forth. You know, just those base kind, you know, lights are on kind of functions, right up to very complex cognitive activities and behavioral activities. So an injury to the brain can disrupt any one of those at almost any level. So if you think about it, anything that makes you can be affected by a brain injury. Okay? And you can have and result in long-term permanent disability as a result of that. So the thing about physical impairments is that the severity of your impairment may also determine your direction on the map. So if you have too much physical disability, then that may direct you in one particular area. If you've got too little, it may direct you to another area, and you may not have access to certain programming. So you have to have just the right level of disability to access programming at the right time. This next slide just talks a little bit about the kind of bajillion kinds of physical consequences of brain injury, and I just put it in here mostly just to give you an idea of the spectrum of things that could happen, from, you know, seizure disorders to paralysis to spasticity to bladder and bowel function anomalies and so on and so forth. In the cognitive domain, So cognitive functions are things like memory and attention, your ability to concentrate, your ability to plan for the future, your ability to recognize error, your ability to have sort of social cognition, the ability to kind of tell whether people are responding to you in a negative or positive way, which is interesting because I'm just staring at a camera right now, so I can't tell whether people are responding to me in a positive or negative way. And it's a bit disconcerting, right? Because we use that as humans. You know, a lot of our communication is in fact nonverbal in our perception of how other people are responding to us, and that's that sort of social cognition component. So that can certainly be impacted post-brain injury. Now, if you have primarily cognitive disability as a result of your brain injury, you probably will not be admitted to an inpatient rehabilitation program for the most part. You will likely be directed to outpatient assessment and treatment. And there's actually relatively few dedicated cognitive rehabilitation programs in Alberta. And they kind of come and they go, and it depends on funding, and it depends on, you know, interested parties and societies to kind of put them together and so on and so forth. So it's a challenge to find dedicated cognitive rehabilitation here in our province. If your cognitive disabilities are too severe, the likelihood is you'll be directed to some kind of supervised living, okay? Because you're going to need some assistance to kind of manage. If you have no memory, you can imagine how challenging that would be. If you can't form new memories, how challenging that would be to manage your day-to-day affairs. Now, behavioral issues after brain injury are also very common, and in fact are extremely common, and the incidence of things like major depressive disorders that are diagnosable, you know, according to sort of DSM criteria, range anywhere from about 10 to 75%, depending on who you read and what the criteria are. Things like, you know, kind of classical psychiatric disorders like mania, anxiety disorders, apathy, psychosis, very common post-brain injury. This, what Rao and Laketsos have called the behavioral discontrol syndrome, is also fairly common. So this is the ability to kind of manage your temper or how long your fuse is before you kind of lose control of your temper. Or your ability to kind of manage a situation in a calm and rational fashion. So also very common post-brain injury. Well, so what's the impact of that? You know, I mean, who cares? It's one of those things, and you know, it's part of brain injury. Well, it's not quite that simple. So in fact, if you read the literature, about 70% or maybe more of all overall disability and traumatic brain injury is actually related to neurobehavioral dysfunction. It's these behavioral issues that create challenges for people in the community. And families will tell you that behavioral issues are actually the most troublesome thing that they deal with. You know, a physical disability you can manage. You know, we're pretty good in our society about, you know, improving access, and people can get in and out of washrooms and in and out of buildings for the most part. But a behavioral disability, is a huge challenge for families. And these problems persist, or they can actually get worse in the years post-injury. So there's a number of studies that have kind of done long-term follow-up that have suggested that, in fact, you know, people who may not have had neurobehavioral disability in the first year or two post-injury may develop them further on, or you can develop different types of behavioral disability as your recovery progresses. And one of the things that happens, of course, is now if you're living in the community and you need to access services, that may be a challenge. So survivors themselves also, by self-report, find that the cognitive and behavioral issues are the most distressing in the years post-injury. As I said, you know, you can typically manage a physical disability reasonably well with adaptive equipment. It's not nice, but it's often manageable. So you have about two times after a brain injury, you have about two times the risk of an Axis 1 disorder, which is, you know, major psychosis or a major depressive episode. Your risk of suicide actually increases about 3 to 4 times from the normal population. And you have about 5 times the risk of developing a depressive disorder. And as you can imagine, that also limits your community reintegration and ability to kind of re-enter or reintegrate with society post-brain injury. So if you look at studies where people have looked at the homeless population in Toronto, Angela Colantonio did a survey looking at the homeless population in Toronto, and about 70% of them had had a pre-morbid traumatic brain injury. In prison populations, about 60 to 75% of people report having had a traumatic brain injury. So despite the importance of this, and despite the issues, there are actually few specific resources that are available. And they may actually, if you have a behavioral issue, that may actually exclude your ability to participate in a rehabilitation program. And there's no, in Alberta, as far as I'm aware, there's no specific neuropsychiatric program that's been developed here yet, and relatively few psychiatrists have an interest in this type of psychiatric disorder. So that can lead to things like inappropriate discharges, very prolonged hospital stays, chemical and physical restraint use, and so on and so forth. So that's led Nathan Cope, actually, to talk about the paradox, what he called the paradox of brain injury rehabilitation, that the presence of a behavioral disturbance, which is the most disruptive and potentially treatable consequence of brain injury, is often the most likely reason that access to appropriate and adequate treatment will be denied. So usually we do it the other way around. So people who are the most severely impaired get the treatment. So that's what triage is all about. So this is kind of a form of reverse triage, according to Cope. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about altering that outcome trajectory and how do we make things best, how do we then improve people's outcome in the few minutes that we have left here. So remembering that you've got an acute care phase, a rehabilitation phase, and a lifelong living phase, so presumably at any point along that continuum of recovery, you could target improvements in function. So what have people done to do that? Well, you know, if you look at this, so this is again another little graphic that's just sort of intended to represent kind of some of the things that can happen at different points along the recovery continuum. So in acute care, you're really trying to deal with the primary insult and trying to support physiologically that individual. And maybe there's ways of helping to limit the amount of damage that happens. So that's things like, you know, ensuring you're well oxygenated, you know, and there's good trauma care and that the medics, you know, do what they need to do and to get you to a trauma center as quickly as possible, that kind of thing. In brain injury, one of the things that happens is there's this phenomenon called secondary injury. So that primary insult, that whack on the head or that steering post through your skull or something, results in a cascade of neurochemical events that cause significant problems for not only the minutes afterwards, but the hours, the days, and even months afterwards. It triggers a healing cascade, it triggers inflammatory responses, it triggers all kinds of other things that are deleterious, including so-called excitotoxicity, where the excitatory neurotransmitters basically just get dumped out into the brain milieu and excite other neurons to death that might have otherwise survived. So that's led to a lot of thought about, well, what can we do to limit this sort of secondary injury cascade? As you move along and you get past that sort of secondary injury phase, which might be months or maybe even years later, what can you then do to improve brain functioning? So what can you do in that long-term chronic phase? Well, maybe there's a way of enhancing brain function that may help people who have enduring brain dysfunction as a result of their injury. Maybe we can do things like regrow new brain cells, or maybe we can do things like fire up the ones that are there and make them work harder and faster and stronger. So that's led to a lot of interest in sort of some other techniques. So I'm going to talk a little bit about those, and I'm just going to superficially cover them because they're often things that people are interested in, and they're things that they hear about a lot in the media. But I think before we do that, I think it's important to talk about what is a good treatment. So when people are considering types of treatments for brain injury or for pretty much anything else, they need to consider what actually is a good treatment. So a treatment should be effective, first of all. So it should actually work. It should do what it says it does. Now, so that means there should be good evidence for why it works. Anecdotal evidence, or, you know, the evidence that you see on the internet all the time, you know, my cousin's brother's uncle went to this place in California and got some treatment, and the next day he was walking. Well, that's anecdotal evidence. Might be true, but it's not evidence, right? So you need good, scientific, well-designed studies to demonstrate that a treatment is effective. So that, you know, the gold standard is generally the double-blind randomized controlled trial, right? It should be safe, so the treatment should be safe. And remember, there's no free lunches, right? So anything that you're gonna do that's supposedly going to alter your brain function could potentially negatively alter that brain function. So you gotta be a little bit careful about that. The treatment should be available. It should be accessible. So, you know, the one clinic in Zurich who offers this particular fancy-dancy treatment that costs $100,000, that is not an available and accessible treatment for the vast majority of people who have sustained a traumatic brain injury. So it should be also affordable. It should be general, the issue of generalizability here is one that we see all the time too. So what'll happen is somebody will publish a report that says, well, if I take extra vitamin D or if I take fish oil, that will improve my brain function and prevent depression. Well, maybe it will, maybe it won't. It's often based on animal data and on lab data. And you have to remember that that's not necessarily generalizable to the human situation, and lab animals are not humans. So there are lots of issues in here about, well, when do you give a treatment? A treatment that you give, you know, maybe a week post-injury might be good. A treatment that you give, the same treatment, you give it 3 months post-injury might not be good, because the milieu inside your brain is shifting and changing throughout all of these secondary injury cascades. So what about changes in things like stroke care? Well, stroke has done a really good job, actually, of altering the trajectory of care and the trajectory of function by sort of this idea that time is brain. So what they want to do is they want to get in there and revascularize or get blood flow going back to your brain in the area of the stroke. So there's quite a strong emphasis on revascularization using things like clot busters, like the thrombolytics. And there's about a 3 or 4 hour window after your stroke where these are effective. They can be given intravenously, they can be given intra-arterially, or you can do mechanical things like the Roto-Rooter. You can go up and, you know, kind of glom onto the clot and actually pull it out with an extraction device. And now we're looking at hyperacute stroke care. So what do you do in that as soon as humanly possible? So in Alberta, we're one of the leaders in this, and particularly in Edmonton, where we now have a stroke ambulance. So we actually have a CT scanner now that is mobile. And the idea is that the faster you can get to that individual who sustained a stroke, and the faster you can revascularize that area of brain, the more limited the amount of damage that's been done by the stroke. In early traumatic brain injury care, there's been lots and lots of animal and preclinical studies that have shown the beneficial effects of modification of this secondary injury cascade that I talked about. And there's, you know, all kinds of treatments, including free radical scavengers, peg sod stuff, progesterone, metalloproteinase inhibitors, et cetera, et cetera. So I won't go through them all. Unfortunately, for the most part, those things have not actually worked. They work in the lab, and this gets back to the generalizability thing. They work in the lab and they work on rats in traumatic brain injury models, but they don't necessarily translate to the acute care human situation. So in fact, over the last few years, the amount of what's actually happened in terms of acute treatment for traumatic brain injury, aside from really good supportive care, is really not much. So most of these things that we'd really had great hopes for have not really panned out at this point. So what about later on? Can you reorganize your brain and restructure it and make it work better? Well, maybe there are ways of doing that, and there's been three main areas of emphasis here: neurorehabilitation, neurofacilitation, and so-called neuroregeneration. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about those things. And as far as neurorehab goes, we now have really good evidence that neurorehabilitation actually works and works good. So if you want to, you know, if you want to look at that evidence, there's a couple of really good Canadian websites where people have done the synthesis of all the evidence that's available in both traumatic or acquired brain injury and in stroke, and the websites are mentioned there. We're now recognizing, I think, at the clinical level that we've known at the animal level since the 60s, that the brain is able to form new connections and reorganize itself functionally as a result of behavioral experience, and that's been given the name neuroplasticity. Okay? So now people are hearing lots and lots and lots about that. So there's some principles of neuroplasticity. So neurons that fire together, wire together. So, you know, they gotta, you know, you gotta do this, and then you gotta do this, and you gotta do this repeatedly before they actually hook up and form a connection. If they're out of sync, they don't link. So if this happens over here and this happens over here, they don't connect together. You have to use it or lose it. So functions disappear if you don't use them. So anybody who has learned a second language or has had some other kind of skill that they've developed in early in life and now try and pick it up again, it's much more challenging. It's not impossible, and you're probably starting from a place better than the novice or somebody who's totally naive, but you lose some of that skill, and that's true in brain function in general. The brain wants to be most efficient, so it prunes stuff that it doesn't need, right? And in my case, I can't remember where I parked my car this morning, so I'm hoping that I can just wander around and, you know, press the button and it'll show up. Because do I really need to know that? Well, maybe not. Maybe I can prune that away. Bad example, maybe, but as I'm wandering around in the freezing cold this afternoon. So if you see me out there, please help me. Practice makes perfect. So you need to practice. You need to do stuff to get good at it. You can't learn to play golf by practicing, you know, 15 minutes every 2 months. It'll never happen. And the tasks have to be behaviorally relevant. So it has to be something that's meaningful in terms of recovery. So this whole concept has actually kind of legitimized rehabilitation, where we were, to some extent, we were stumbling around in the dark without necessarily, you know, we knew it worked, we weren't real sure how to do it. It's legitimized that, right? And now we know, and we can demonstrate using neuroimaging techniques, that we can actually change brain function as a result of therapy activity. And that's been shown in fMRI, TMS mapping, and so forth. So this idea that we've been rethinking rehabilitation as learning is actually really helpful. So if you think about recovery and the regaining of functions as learning, it means that learning principles that we understand pretty well, and everybody sort of, I guess, has some intuitive sense of, should apply to neuro rehab and the recovery of function. So the amount of practice is important. The intensity and duration of your practice is important. You know, and that's led to the use of things like robots. So maybe robots now can deliver therapy that you could do for 10 hours a day, where it would be very difficult to pay a therapist to do that. Because robots don't have unions and they generally don't complain, and you can fire them up 7 days a week and, you know, 24 hours a day if you needed to. So there's a lot of interest in robotic rehabilitation now. The type of practice that you do is important. The consistency of your practice, the specificity of your practice, and the maintenance of your skill. So you have to use it or you'll lose it. The same as with any other kind of learning. You also then also need to optimize your learning environment, and that means both you and the environment that you're learning in. So very difficult to learn if you're tired, you're fatigued, you're depressed, or there's some other factor that's impairing your ability to pay attention to what you're doing. The other important part about this is that your learning capacity never stops. Okay? So just because you've had a brain injury doesn't mean your brain isn't capable of reorganizing itself and relearning. So that I think is a critical thing to kind of take away, is that we never lose the capacity to reorganize our brains and learn new things. Right? So even though we tend to think of rehabilitation as being a serial thing where you have your injury, you get your rehab, and then you're out, you're still quite capable of reorganizing and relearning in that lifelong living phase. Okay, so how could you optimize your brain function? I think I got about 3 minutes left here. So how can you optimize your brain function and learning capacity? Well, maybe you can fire it up with some drugs. Maybe there's some drug treatments that you can use to enhance, say, your attention or your memory or that kind of thing. Maybe we can use non-invasive brain stimulation and kind of stimulate your brain to work better. Maybe we can make it work better by exposing you to some hyperbaric oxygen, something like that, which is a pretty common treatment that people seek. Or maybe you can regrow functional brain tissue. Well, so can brain function be positively affected by drugs? Well, it looks like it. But again, you would think for something that would be, that seems like kind of a no-brainer, especially given that our medical system is very biased towards pharmacologic treatments, you would think there would be a fair bit of data in this. But there is relatively few studies, and there's no real clinics that are specific to this area. There is some data that says that amantadine, for example, might be useful to wake people up a little bit faster in the minimally conscious state. Methylphenidate or Ritalin might be helpful for people with attentional deficits. The early use of amphetamine-like drugs may actually improve motor recovery and stroke. Things like fluoxetine or Prozac may actually help recovery and stroke regardless of the antidepressant effects of that by modulating some other neural function. Things like beta blockers for agitation and so forth. I won't go through them all, but there is some evidence that some of these medications may actually help to improve your attention and concentration as well as your memory. Now, you have to temper that with the idea that and recognition that there are negative effects of drugs and brain injury as well. So we know that there are lots of side effects, and people end up on lots of medications after their brain injuries or after their hospitalizations. So I think the important thing is to remember that some of those things may also adversely affect brain injury. So lots of drugs have side effects like sedation, cognitive blunting, seizures, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So those things alone can interfere with your daily activity and with your rehabilitation. So if you're sleepy and dopey because you're on some kind of medication that's making you sleepy and dopey, the likelihood of you getting full benefit from your participation in a rehab program or a training program is affected. So the other thing that's important is that they might actually slow or inhibit the degree of recovery after injury. So this is an important thing that's been shown in animal studies, has not yet kind of made it into the human world that much, but it does raise the interesting concern that some of the medications that we use post-brain injury may actually slow or inhibit your ability to recover. Okay, well, I'm gonna skip over that slide. We're gonna talk about non-invasive brain stimulation a bit. This is a new thing that's kind of coming along the pipe. So this is transcranial magnetic stimulation. So you can actually stimulate brain function from outside with a big magnetic field, and basically just hold a big coil up next to your head, fire a current through it, and then that induces a current in your brain tissue and actually modulates brain activity. So it's been shown to be useful in depression and all kinds of other interesting things that I'll tell you about in a second. The other way of modulating brain activity with electricity is a thing called transcranial DC stimulation, which is basically a sponge and a 9-volt battery. So basically you wet the sponge, stick it on, hook a battery up between you and the reference electrode, and the areas under those electrodes are preferentially biased towards either be a bit more excitable or a bit less excitable. So you can see where that might be of some benefit if you've got a penumbra of tissue around an area of injury that is sort of hanging in there, kind of functioning, kind of not functioning. Maybe if you put that electrode on there and stimulate the function underneath there, you can actually stimulate some reconnection and some recovery. So in fact, that's actually been shown now to affect mood and cognition, improve your visual working memory. This is in people without brain injury. Improve memory consolidation. It can alter your decision-making capacity, which is a bit scary. It can challenge your probabilistic decision-making ability, your moral judgments, problem-solving, and so on and so forth. It has been used in stroke, and both TDCS and TMS have been shown to improve naming for objects, speech output, motor recovery, and mood. And in traumatic brain injury, both TDCS and transcranial magnetic stimulation have been shown to improve attention and actually swallowing function as well. So that's an interesting and very unique treatment that's now coming down the pipe, and there's a lot of interest in this. In fact, I just noticed on the CBC news feed that somebody at the University of Manitoba just got $1.7 million to study this in trying to prevent the decline in Alzheimer's disease in that sort of neurodegenerative population. Well, what about hyperbaric oxygen? So I get asked about this quite frequently. What about HBOT? There are lots of providers that sell this. You can go and do a few dives, and the idea is that you're actually getting exposed to oxygen at up to 3 times normal atmospheric pressure. And in theory, what happens, or the idea was initially that you were going to drive more oxygen into the brain, and somehow if you got more oxygen in there, the brain would work better. Well, there's actually been some animal studies that have shown that in the acute situation, you actually get pretty good recovery and increased survivability in the acute situation. So that's led to a lot more interest in this as a potential therapy. It also looks like it can do things like reduce cerebral edema, might improve mitochondrial function in the cells themselves, and can decrease cell death in that sort of secondary injury cascade. In humans, there actually have been a couple of studies where people have looked at the acute treatment, and it actually looks like acute hyperbaric oxygen might decrease mortality and improve Glasgow Coma Scale scores. However, we don't really use it. So as far as I'm aware, there is really no hyperbaric oxygen treatment for traumatic brain injury available anywhere in Canada. So there is the chronic situation where people have the idea that maybe it'll help, you know, long term in that lifelong living phase. There's been quite a few studies looking at that, and there is no evidence that it's helpful. Okay? If you look at the systematic reviews and meta-analyses, and there's really no benefit that's been demonstrated for mild or severe brain injury for function, quality of life, or even mild TBI symptoms. Okay, well, lastly, what about neural regrowth, the promise of stem cells? And I think probably everybody in the audience has, you know, remembers the Gordie Howe story, right? So Mr. Howe had a severe stroke, went for what was billed as stem cell treatments, and then supposedly was walking the next day, at least according to media reports. Well, the idea of stem cells is that we have inside our brain cells that are capable of not only being stimulated to regenerate, but maybe we can put other cells in there that will differentiate into new brain cells or new support cells and then improve function. So that's provided a lot of interest, as you can imagine, right? And it's not just in brain injury, it's in almost every area of human biology where people are looking at this now. So it's led to the idea that maybe we could find these neural progenitor cells and just grow new brain cells and then make them work somehow. Or maybe it modulates other processes in that secondary injury cascade or changes inflammatory responses or does something that will help. Well, there's lots of animal research. The problem is that there's a relatively small amount of published human research. And there's a couple of reasons for that, partly because these are challenging studies to do, but also because there's a lot of proprietary interest in this area. So there are a lot of companies who are working on this who don't necessarily want to share their data and don't necessarily want to publish in the open literature. There is one study that by Zhu and colleagues who actually took tissue from people who had open brain injury, so their brain tissue was exposed. They actually took some of the tissue out of that gaping wound and then cultured those cells up and tried to grow them up and got them to, you know, multiply the cells and then re-implanted them into the area and supposedly showed an increase in function and post-injury. There's a little bit of company research that I was able to find. This is some data from Athersys. And I think you can see that even though that does look like there's a bit of a positive effect in stroke, the effects are not as spectacular as you get your stem cells and walk out of there the next day. So if you look here and you look at the what they call multi-stem compared to placebo, this is excellent outcome at day 90 in over 1 year. So about 23% versus 9% roughly. So again, you know, significant increase, and if it actually pans out, that'd be pretty cool, but it's not the spectacular, world-beating treatment that you hear about on the media and on the internet. Okay, well, I'm going to stop there. So I ran a little bit over, and I apologize, but I think we have time for questions, actually. So I'll turn it over to Paige, and if anybody has a question, please feel free to chat away. And
sure. So our first question is from Amanda. She is asking, can you please make some suggestions for community-based treatment for a patient being released from prison who may not be a good fit for regular programming due to a significant impulsivity, aggression, and other problematic behavioral issues?
Boy, that's a bit more than a quick answer, I think. I guess in general terms, I think you need to know the patient well, and you need to know that person well, and what their interests are, and what their goals may be, what kind of community supports they have available to them, and what kinds of programming might be available to them or not available to them. And then I think the other issues are around, who was that individual, and are there any other mental health or addiction issues that need to be dealt with as well? So is some of that impulsivity and sort of aggressive type behavior, is that related to a mental health issue, and can be that can that be modulated in some way that may help that individual to access other services or arenas that he may not be otherwise eligible for? So I think one of the very key things in all of this is, you know, you really need a good, thorough assessment of the individual, and you need to address all of those issues. You know, what's the spectrum of cognitive issues for that individual? What residual capacity do they have that you can then take advantage of and try and enhance? You know, there's issues around sort of insight-oriented therapy as well, you know, in the sense of, can you help an individual to gain some perspective on how their behavior may impact others and why people react to them the way they do? That's sometimes a challenge for people post-brain injury. So that's kind of the long, rambling answer to that. Hopefully that's helpful.
So our next question is from Tracy. She was wondering if you happen to know the neural disability percentage rates for FASD versus TBI.
The incidence rates? I don't, actually. I'm not a FASD guy, unfortunately. The incidence is not insignificant, that's for sure, but I can't give you exact numbers, I'm sorry. Yeah.
And our last question here is if you can point us in the direction of some of the mental health resources that are available.
That's a challenge. That is definitely a challenge. So, in my experience, one of the issues with access to mental health services has been that if you have a brain injury, that may actually exclude you from access to services. So sometimes individuals, though, have exactly the same issues that somebody without a brain injury may be having as well. They can be depressed, they can have anxiety disorders, they can have adjustment disorders that maybe need a little adjustment in terms of what you would need to assist that person with, or there may be medication treatments that are exactly the same as you would use in somebody who had not had a brain injury, for example. So if you're depressed, would an antidepressant be a benefit? Well, perhaps, but that requires assessment by somebody who has an interest in this area, or advocacy in terms of trying to help some of the concerns that mental health professionals may have in terms of dealing with somebody with a brain injury. So some degree of advocacy on the part of a service provider may also be helpful that, hey, listen, you know, I mean, yeah, there's these issues, but really the concern that we have is this guy's really down and depressed, and you know that's not what he was like 6 months ago. So there's something that's happened that's not necessarily directly related to the consequence of the brain injury. Okay, well, I think we're coming to the end of our session here. So I'd just like to thank everybody. And I had a little blurb here somewhere, which seems to have disappeared. Oh, there we go. Yeah. So as I mentioned earlier in the opening, today's webcast is part of the Government of Alberta's Human Services Learning Series, which runs the third week of every month through June of 2017. And this series will go on to cover topics from acquired brain injury, like the one you saw today. But there are some other series that talk about employment, FASD, which is germane to the question that somebody asked earlier that I couldn't answer, as well as a session around the Office of the Public Guardian and Public Trustee. So stay tuned for information on next month's webcast, and if you need to get information on registration and updates about each of these sessions, you can email us at abii@gov.ab.ca and ask to be added to the mailing list. And you can also find past and future webcasts and sign up at hslearningseries.ca. Just a reminder that today's webcast was recorded and the video will be posted online along with the videos from all the previous webcasts that have happened in this series. And the video link will be sent out to the registrants in the near future. And we'd encourage you to share this video with anybody you think that might be interested. And from my perspective, thanks for inviting me along, and I guess we'll end the session. Thank you.